Anyone here that does not speak German? Should it be English? English. Okay? English it is. Welcome to my session about Drupal commerce. The session is built up around a use case, and the intention of the session is to show you what can be done with commerce as it is today. We have done it and do this in a way that you see this in live examples. I'm not going to, I did a technical talk about this in Drupal Camp in Iceland. This talk's not going to be so technical. It's more going to be centered on like what was achieved. And how was it done? This talk is for you, so you are very welcome to just interrupt me and ask me questions if you like. And you can also point out to me like stuff that you want to know specifically, right? Because like I don't do this for me, for my joy, but for you. Okay, so I'm Christoph. I'm from Onex Internet, and this is about Drupal 8 and commerce 2. So why do we want to use Drupal commerce? Us, I'm speaking now as us, as being one of the owners of Onex Internet. And the reason is that Drupal 8 is just a great system. It's great functionality, it has a great API. We love working with it. We've been working with it like for a year now. We do everything in Drupal 8, and it's just really awesome. And we want to be able to use the same technology in when we build commerce websites. Because we want to have all the awesome functionality and the possibilities available when we build e-business solutions as when we build regular web-based solutions. As you know, commerce is still beta. There are many of the previously existing contributed modules don't exist yet or are still on an early stage. And we are facing the question, how should we just, when's the correct point to that we dare start building e-business solutions based on commerce 2? I assume that goes for most of you. Who has built commerce 2 solutions here in the room? Commerce 2, like Drupal 8 Commerce 2? Okay, yeah, Commerce 2, like Drupal 8 Commerce 2, exactly. This is probably the situation that you're all facing. Is this ready? You know, can we use it? Do we dare to do this now? You know, adoption of Drupal 8 was already difficult. There's lots of hurdles, lots of learnings. You had to, steep learning curves you had to go through, and now commerce, and that's so early. Should we do it? Should we not do it? That's exactly the question that we were facing. We had in the summer last year, we had a request from a client to build a web shop. And we wanted to do this in commerce too, and we just didn't know. So we approached the commerce guys at DrupalCon in Dublin directly after the talk. And like for those of you who were in Dublin and were at that talk, like Ryan and Matt, they announced the first beta release of commerce in Dublin. And we approached them afterwards and talked about it. And then we made a get together with them, with Ryan and Bojan, who's the main developer in commerce too, together with Matt. And we just spoke about like what's possible, what's not possible. And they confirmed at this time that meaning beta is that they will provide an upgrade path to future modules. You know, so we will secure that stuff we build that in early beta stages or in beta stages in general would be able to upgrade on a later stage at point in time. And secondly, they confirmed that the API of Commerce 2 would not change anymore. So it means any functionality that we would like to have in the system that was not ready out of the box or maybe just was missing the UI to click it together, we could just program this in, and that will always work with future versions. Right? So this is the information we got in a meeting with them, and then we decided that we were good to go. So, quick overview of the new commerce, what do you have, what we have in it. I'm not going to compare this to Drupal 7 commerce now. If you have or first version of commerce, if you have done this, you will see the differences. But you have like the full feature set that you just need in a modern e-business application. You have languages, you have stores, different stores within one website. You have currencies, you have, of course, product variation attribute and so forth. You have taxation, you have shipping, shipping zones, you know, shipping areas, you know, full flexibility. You have orders, you have checkout, you have payment, stock management, and everything else. All of this, what you see here, is built into ORLO WATCHES, that's the webshop that I'm going to show, and yeah, so you get use case of all of this. So about ORLO itself, ORLO is a Copenhagen watch brand. It was founded by the former brand manager of GEORG JENSEN, which is one of the most famous Danish design companies, together with a watch designer from very experienced watch, and actually also well-known watch designer from Denmark, who has been working for all the large brands and making watches for Diesel and all kinds of brands. And they got together in 2016 in order to launch a new watch brand. To give you an idea how this is, so they have in the initial design phase, or in the founding phase of the company in 2016, they designed 5 different watches. They grouped into collections, we call this collections, right? So 5 different collections, and they produced 6,000 watches. And they launched their official operations on the 1st of April in 2017, so a couple of days back. Here's the link, so you can go check out the site, you will see exactly the same. I have for this presentation snipped out the functionality that I want to show into short video clips, so that we don't have to go back and forth and not click around. But everything you see here is just recorded from the website yesterday and actually this morning. Okay. There's also a few. Besides, so the team of the ORLO team consists of the brand manager, the designer, and the sales team, international sales team. They have sales, like sales representatives and sales agents in Denmark and Scandinavia, as well as a very strong social media team, right? And they have they're running strong campaigns with doing influencer marketing and these types of online social media activities. And yeah, and as an example of this, I just put here a video for your reference if you want to take a look and get to know more about like the people and stuff behind it, how they actually approach sales and online marketing. You can just check this here at this link that is taken from their Facebook social media profile. Okay, let's take a look at the shop. Yes. So that's just a quick run over the shop. So you see here the first collection of the website. You know, this is the Copenhagen collection before with the Bauman collection. You see this always there. You have the Oslo collection. You see a totally different style that's very retro. That's a 60s style watch. And you have the Hitch collection, which is also a retro watch, but it's more a flight type of watch. Then on the website itself, you have like about them section. You have like again access points to access the products. And on the bottom, you have a journal, which is basically a blog, you know, in which they can show information about them. So the website is, of course, fully responsive because it's actually tailored to all devices, and we expect to see much sale from mobile devices. And here, then the product itself, called collections, they grouped into subpages in which you just have, you know, commerce style overview of the products that are available for purchase. Okay, that was just an overview of the website, just give you a feeling with this, how this is. Okay, first thing we've built in is the shop is multi-store, multi-language, multi-currency, and multi-country. So what does that mean? When you build international shops, you always have the problem, you have different currencies in which you sell, you have different shipping costs based on where you ship to, you have different prices for the countries that you want to sell in, and the countries that you sell in are not necessarily bound to one language. Right? For example, in Switzerland, you know, what's the language if you want to enter a Swiss store, which is paid in Swiss francs, right? Should it be English or French or German, right? So you have to separate language from, from the store that you actually have. So how this is done here is that we operate with 5 stores. We operate with a Danish store in which products are sold at Danish prices in Danish kronas and shipped to Denmark. We have a Swedish store in which is Swedish kronas and shipped to Sweden, and Norway, same thing. Then we have an EU store, which is all other European countries with the same shipping rates, and the euro, in which prices are displayed in euros, and the euro prices apply. And we have an international store, which is also in Europe, but ships worldwide, has different shipping costs. So across euro prices, we don't differentiate between the price, right? But we could, you know, you could have like cheaper watches with the same currency, because it's not bound to the currency, it's bound to the store. How this is done here, that you, when you enter the web page in the beginning, you know, on ORLOWatches.com, you are forced to select what store you want to go into. So in that case, what you see here in the demonstration is that I enter first, I think, the German store, and then I switch to the Danish store, right? And you see also that when you look at the details of the product, that that the prices, I don't know if you just caught this just earlier, that the prices here, scroll down a little bit, please. So you have here the prices in, that's not easy to see, but the prices here are in euro, and when you switch to a different country, the prices are actually different. You saw a language selection too. In the language selection currently, you can only select English. That's pure translation issue, but the Danish and Swedish and Norwegian texts are not ready yet, therefore you can only select English. Yes, it's also done like this. When you enter the Danish store, you can only ship to Denmark. That has tons of reasons, has tax reasons, for example. If you build up your e-commerce store like this, and you say, here you ship to Denmark, then you can show Danish VAT. And if you ship to Swedish, you can show Swedish VAT, or you can choose to show no VAT. Right? So like here in this case, like the store selection binds also the taxation that applies to the products. Okay, continue. Let's look at product and variations. So, the product exists multiple times on the website. That was indicated here. So the products are sold. All watches are actually gender-neutral products. You know, there are women that like to have big, fat, you know, masculine watches, and they are like guys that like to have like a slim, fine watch. You know, so watch design nowadays is usually gender neutral, or it's just allowed for everyone to just buy every type of watch. So therefore, what we have here is that we have the same products in different contexts. So this is what I'm illustrating here. So I'm entering to the same watch through multiple paths in order for a sales strategy in which you can target, for example, if you want to make advertisements at female online magazines that link to the web page, that you can just reframe the user from the source into the shop in the correct context. Right? So this is achieved here. This is just a question that you will always be facing, like how to do this, you know? So we actually work with, because if you know this from commerce, how this is built internally, commerce always has a product has stock keeping unit and the same like a number, an SKU, right? And an SKU is just that's a unique product that must be unique in a shop. So that's the same thing here. So if we have the same product shown once in a gender neutral context, once in a male context, and one in a female context, it's actually the same product. So we didn't go so far as to build in the mechanism that you can just like, you know, display products in different contexts, so they are just physically real products. That was not so much an obstacle, because all products also have EN numbers attached, because there's a connection to a warehouse system in which like the products are automatically packaged and shipped, and they don't work with our stock keeping numbers in the first place, they work with the EN numbers that are given, so therefore in the end this translates back again to the same products. Okay, let's take a look at checkout and payment. So we have here for the products, we have related products that's built with like a watch typically has like a strap, right? And very nice business in watch sales is selling additional straps so that you can customize your watch, you know, with different strap color sizes or types. And but they are of course related, right? So here for example, that's exactly Drupal standard mechanism that you just have a product, and then that product you can just relate other products to that that are then shown below in order to allow for cross-selling or upselling. And yeah, this is standard Drupal. So this is what you see here on the side. Like Drupal Commerce comes with a standard card view, like always. We chose here the solution not to just use the standard visualization of what Commerce 2 just brings out of the box. Instead, since Commerce has a great API, you can just call the card on the API, and you can also do this client side. And also, you actually have no problems of just integrating like a card that slides in from the side, as this is done here. And also, like what you see out in the corner, I don't know if this is visible here. I'm just changing the quantity. You see how the price changes when you change the quantities of the items in the cart. You know, that's just a regular standard Drupal AJAX callback function that just changes the available content in the DOM on the side. In checkout, we have guest and authenticated user checkout. We will skip this step for the future because you see you have a login button on the upper right corner, and in online and watch sales, you typically do not have so many returning customers. So actually, like distinguishing between like do you want to be a login user or like anonymous user is not so important. So we're going to skip this step. It will always be either when you anonymous checkout when you're not logged in, or it will be login authenticated checkout. So that step will be skipped. Also what you can do nicely, what we did here and with Commerce 2, is that this is true checkout of users without creating user profiles. You know, so often, like how we mostly did this in previous versions of Commerce, when you said I want to have anonymous user checkout, there were still all these rules in place in Commerce 1 that user account would be created and your order would be associated to that user account. That is not like this in Commerce 2 anymore. Commerce 2, you can just really place an order, create an order in the checkout process, and ship that order without storing any user profile information. What you also saw here in the end, so this is not out of the box, like one page checkout kind of feeling, you know. It's not 100% one page checkout, right? Because you see obviously that we go to a payment pane, you know. This is not standard in Commerce. We have to like build something in there. But again, we were just using the API, how they have it, and that was really nice. Here what you see is integration with the payment provider, that's a Danish payment provider, DIPS. That was also really straightforward to just, you know, implement an old payment provider and Commerce 2, so this actually also just worked nicely. Okay. What is the stuff that was out of the box, and what is the stuff that you had to build then? So obviously you had to make some, you know, general modules. We had to make a shipping module, because we wanted to have our own shipping rates attached based on the store you're in. You know? This is really nicely done in Commerce, because you just have a shopping cart and you can add adjustments to that shopping cart. And anything is adjustment. It doesn't matter if you just put in a coupon that gives you a rebate, however you calculate this then, or if it's tax that you want to, you know, deduct or add to coupon you want to deduct, the tax you want to add to the amount of the basket, or if it's a shipping rate. You know, so here we just made our own module, payment module that didn't exist, there was no integration of DIPS, we had to do this one. We made very, I want to show this, we made a very simple stock module, because we have in the connection to the warehouse system, we have access to the amount of products that are in stock, right? So we can just really easy, you know, modify stock levels and set and retrieve stock levels, and yeah, that was connected with this warehouse module. So here a little bit of overview of the main modules we did. I'm not going into technical details, but why this is here is just to show you that this is just real nice, beautiful, object-oriented Drupal 8 code that you can produce. So if you like working with Drupal 8, and you like with working with all the goodness that Drupal 8 and Symfony provides, this is what your modules that you produce in the end will look like. And you have nice, easy to read, nice to maintain code. As a deeper example, I want to show the stock module, and that is just really drop that simple. You have an event subscriber that just reacts on that products are put into the shopping basket, or removed from the shopping basket, or purchased, and then you just modify the stock levels on that product, on this event. It's really simple. So how did the project go? We had a steep learning curve. You know, just like when we started with Drupal 8 about a year ago, you know, like our learning curve was just like this. We did many things wrong and twice, but as soon as you have it figured out, you know, you really start liking it, you can really work much faster, more efficient, and produce much better software. And the same we actually also saw with commerce. You know, so like once we had like understood like how this commerce was built up, it was really easy for us to work with it and change it. And we have since then, so we were working on Mothershop at the same time, you know, they came out probably at the same time. We just now recently, like 1 week back or so, finished the third workshop, and that was just done in under 3 weeks and didn't even include any custom modules. There's this one here, that's the only one that I'm going to show quickly. So what you see now here, that is just standard commerce too. North, auto shop has products here, you know, grouped into men, women, Zubehör. It's about Reitzubehör. I don't know how you say this in English. Reitzubehör? Anyone? Okay, Reitzubehör, you know, for Reit animals. And yeah, so similar, you know, like standard Drupal design, certain products, you know, let's take it.
Horse gear.
Horse gear. Yeah. Did you look it up or did you know?
Right. Horse rider.
So this is what you see here now, this is just now absolute standard commerce. You know, this is just products, this is views, this is just like categorization with taxonomies and stuff. Display of this information, you know, like here, this take here, this nice jacket, you know, I want to have it like a different color, you know, and I want to have it in Excel, I want to have two, and I want to put it to the basket, you know, I want to go to the basket, and I want to go to payment. Right? Okay.
Can you press
the right dance? Yeah. Yeah. Yes, completely standard. With PayPal integration, completely standard how this goes. Yes. That's it. Questions, please?
Did you consider Uber card or did you focus on commerce right from the beginning?
So it's Drupal 8 and we've never used Uber card, also not in Drupal 7, so therefore we had no experience with it and therefore we didn't consider it in Drupal 8.
And the second is, I looked at your ORLO shop in Germany and I noticed that the tax rate was 25%, shouldn't it be 19%?
Say again, please. Tax size?
Tax rate 25%, and in Germany the tax rate is 19%. So shouldn't it change according to the country you choose?
So in Germany you are actually in all the EU. I'm not 100% sure. If you sell out of Denmark to Germany or France, I'm not sure. I don't know, but we didn't consult them on like the tax rate that should apply. Like the shops that exist, you have international EU and then Denmark, Sweden, Norway. They don't distinguish between EU, they don't distinguish between Austria, Germany, Switzerland or France. And why they then apply 25% tax, I don't know, I'm not sure.
But I can tell you from they use the 25% because that is the VAT in the country where they ship from, which is Denmark, and because they're already that they're still that small, that they like again, like Christoph, we are not tax consultants. So please, what I say is just what based on the information from the client, is that they are using 25%, which is the tax rate in Denmark, and they are showing that in EU, as they are shipping the product from Denmark, and they are not selling that much in Germany, but they need to apply the German VAT. So therefore they apply that.
But if I create a shop, an online shop here in Germany, and I ship to any other country, I would have to show the tax rate of the recipient.
According to the information is, that depends on the amount you ship. Like just because you allow for shipping to Angola, you know, you don't have to reprogram your shop that you just show Angolan tax rates. It depends on the amount of business you do. I know, like with Austria, for example, it's like this. If you ship to Austria, you know, there's like a threshold of like more than 30,000 euro revenue or something like this, then you need to get an Austrian VAT number, and then you can use Austrian tax rates when you ship from Germany.
The law has changed. Yeah. Now you have, even if you're a small retailer, you have to charge the tax rate of the recipient company.
I don't know how this is done.
So that problem there is more like a structural problem, not a technical problem.
Yeah.
No. Questions?
How do you synchronize with the external stock keeping software? Is it an ERP, I assume? How do you synchronize? Is it like immediately or every day or something like that?
No, it has a latency. So on the shop side, it works like this. When you put it into the basket, we decrease the stock level. Mm-hmm. When the basket expires or you remove it from the basket, we increase the stock level. If you check out the product, it stays decreased, right? And it goes to the warehouse. However, the warehouse also sends stock information back because like when products go into the warehouse, you know, there comes like a box, usually box then with 1,000 watches that gets put into the shelves, and then they place a file in the synchronization. It's actually FTP based, right? So they place a file with structured data in the FTP space, we pick that up, and we adjust the stock levels accordingly. So it's not real time, it is asynchronously, but as soon as we receive it, we pick it up.
And how do you know that there's a new version?
Of what?
Is there a signal from the ERP that there's a new version, or do you just check every...
No, we check frequently, you know, and they check frequently too. Like when we drop an order into their target folder, you know, they also pick it up, and I don't know how they do it, if they monitor the folder. On our side, we just check in at periodic intervals.
Okay. And what ERP is used, can you say that?
This is not an ERP system, so they have three systems used. They have because we send to the warehouse company and they talk to the Danish ERP system. So that is wired together because that's the biggest Danish shipping company for products, and they connect with this much better than we do. So it doesn't matter if we tell the warehouse, tell the ERP decrease stock, or they do, you know. So in that case, we didn't make a direct ERP connection. We only, we only talk to the warehouse.
And the customer?
Yeah, one thing, yeah, yes.
The customer data, you synchronize them also through another system?
We send the customer data with the order to the warehouse, and they synchronize it in. So also like, in other shops, we also take care of like talking to ERP systems, you know, or like just separate billing systems, you can do that too. And but in the case here, we only talk to the warehouse system because they pass the customer data on, the necessary customer data onto the ERP system.
Thanks.
Yeah? Yes?
I would have a question and three mentions what I saw on a page. Question will be, you mentioned on Star that you have base products with an individual SKU, with an individual EN number, and that regarding on the shop, you display it regarding on the shop on an area parameter. So like, if you have a base price, I assume, for a product, 100 euro in Germany, then if it's another country, another taxation, then you change that number regarding the taxation
yep.
and display it regarding it. And my question would be, like, if you like showing some prices, like if you divide a number with a funny taxation rate, you get also a funny number. Like, do you have any filters, any adjustment for those, or did I misunderstand the explanation of the design of the?
Yeah, so the prices they put in prices including tax, right, from which we calculate what is the tax rate that you have in that price, right? So and then we just calculate, you know, and that will just lead to that the tax included tax is 10 euros 0.54 or something like this. You know, that's good enough for us. The question, how the correct, so one product just has many prices, right? It has a euro price, has a krona price of the different krona types, and you see here a price resolver down here, right? And this here in this class just takes care of resolving to that the correct price is used, right? That, and in our case, as the price resolver is linked with the store resolver that you see below, you know, because our price is bound to the store, but could be anything. You can bind the price with a mechanism like this to a user role, or you can bind it to whatever you want to bind it to.
So you're having a base product with a base price and then modulate it, like regarding the...
No, we have one product with many prices.
Oh, right.
So what we do, you caught that correctly in the beginning, due to the fact that we show the product three times on the page, same product three times, yeah. We had to create three products with exactly the same prices. That's a bit, you know, that could be improved. We just didn't go so far because the first, you know, version of the shop is also has to see like how the company progresses, like how many more products there will be, you know, how difficult or easy it will be to manage it. But so we didn't make a mechanism for just like allowing the product to be shown in three different contexts. We just duplicated the products two times, you know, kept everything the same, and only just changed the text. Only the marketing people changed the text on it, changed the imagery on it, and that's it. But could potentially also change the price.
Right.
And this then had another SKU, you know, even though it's the same product. So like it was really the same watch, you know, but we had them, and then the watch exists like the SKU, and then has like a suffix, an M on L or no suffix, and that would be the on the commerce side due to the architecture of commerce is built, the stock keeping unit needs to be unique, you know, this is how we solve this. Yeah.
Is there a mass import data?
You see it's 4 collections and with like 20 watches each, you know, like three colors, you know, two sizes, or two, three colors, two, three sizes. Yeah, and you know, so there was no mass import, not necessary at the time. But in other shops we've done this, and this can be easily done with Drupal 8 to, you know, synchronize data without problem.
How would you do that with teams?
Probably not.
No.
Probably it depends on how the data is made accessible. You know, I would not expect that like products would come somewhere. I would just more expect like a REST endpoint or something like this. And then probably it would just be a custom import. But if it was XML, then you could just also use feeds. That's it.